we finish our series in the book of Acts. Paul was in Rome. Of course, he had been accused by the Jews of bringing a Gentile into the temple area, which was a crime punishable by death to the Jews. And Paul knew he couldn't get a fair trial in Jerusalem, so he appealed to Caesar. He used his citizenship to keep him from being extradited back to Jerusalem. We'll talk a little bit about that in a couple of weeks. But today we want to pick up the last chapter in Acts, the last account of Paul. He's in prison, he's in Rome, he's waiting to stand trial before Caesar. The 1999 movie, The Sixth Sense, and I perhaps could have called this sermon The Sixth Sense. 9-year-old Cole Sear can see dead people. And they call in a psychiatrist to help him, a psychologist rather, by the name of Dr. Malcolm Crowe, who is played by Bruce Willis. And he tries to help him in the process. And at the end of the movie, he finds out that he himself is dead. In the early part of the movie, you see this doctor being shot by one of his patients who was dissatisfied with the results of his counseling. And then in the end of the movie, you find out that he really was killed and he was unaware of it. There are a number of people in this world, the vast majority of them, that are dead and unaware of it. In the movie, The Night of the Living Dead, it's a gory movie. I only could watch about 2 or 3 minutes of it and I had enough. But it's about zombies who come back from the dead. And what do? They eat living people. There has been, ever since the fall, a struggle between those that are alive in Christ and the dead. And we experience that struggle regularly. And so we want to learn something about it today. But the point that I want to make is both films have the dead mingling with the living. And we need to know how to deal with that and what God would have us do, because we surely are living among the dead. And so as we close the book of Acts, we want to discover then, how do I live as a believer? And we use the term born again, and we'll look at that as we go along, in Christ. How do I live among the dead? And what does Christ want me to do and know and understand? The first thing I'd like to suggest is that we need to understand the gospel message. That's a very important foundation. Here it is, the message of the gospel. Here's the first truth. All are born dead spiritually. All are born dead spiritually. So when you and I were born, we were born already separated from God, and it didn't take long for us to act out that separation. Acts chapter 28, verse 17, Paul is declaring to the Jews in Rome, and it says, after 3 days, he called together the local leaders of the Jews. And when they had gathered, he said to them, brothers, though I have done nothing against our people or the customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. But notice what he says next. For this reason, therefore, I have asked to see you and speak with you, since it is because of the hope of Israel that I am wearing this chain. What was the hope of Israel? Israel had believed and still does believe that a Messiah is coming, an anointed one. They got a little confused in understanding who the Messiah is. The Messiah was to come and have a righteous rule. They were more interested in the Messiah coming and having a political rule. And so they were looking for a Messiah. And when they read Old Testament passages about the Messiah, they were confused because they read about a suffering servant. And so they had to come up with some kind of explanation. So they said that Israel was the suffering servant and the Messiah would come and deliver Israel from its suffering. Of course, they totally misunderstood what God was saying in the Old Testament. So in Acts chapter 28, verse 20, for this reason, therefore, I've asked to see you and to speak with you, since it is because of the hope of Israel. I'm speaking about the hope of Israel. I want you to know that I want to tell you about the Messiah. And that was his whole purpose in gathering together. verse 22, but they said, we desire to hear from you. He brought them together. We desire to hear from you and what your views are, because with regard to the sect, Christianity was seen as a sect from Judaism. With regard to the sect, we know that everywhere it's spoken against. Did you know that Christianity being spoken against is nothing new? That is to happen throughout its beginning. And why has it been spoken against? Well, the night of the living dead. The world is filled mostly with dead people. And so they do not understand the call of the cross. They do not understand the purpose of Christ coming. And so they are against Christianity. One reason they're against them is they realize that when you become a Christian, your life is different and distinct, and you don't live the way the world lives, and that's a bit aggravating to the world. And so there's this turning, this resisting of the gospel, and this pressure against those who name the name of Christ. In Acts chapter 28, verse 23, and when they had appointed a day for him, they came to him at his lodging in greater numbers. So everybody's excited to hear what Paul's about to say. From morning till evening, he expounded to them, testifying to the kingdom of God. Notice what he was doing now, and trying to convince them about Jesus, both from the law of Moses and from the prophets. What Paul was trying to do was to demonstrate that Jesus Christ was the Messiah. He was the anointed one. He was the one who came on their behalf. And he is using the Old Testament to declare who Jesus is. Can you imagine what he might have said? He was an Old Testament scholar. He knew it well. And so you can imagine he was quoting from the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 53, verse 5. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. And so he's explaining that the suffering servant of the Old Testament, the one who was pierced, is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ who hung on a cross. He would go on, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And he would be preaching the gospel, and he would be pointing out that we are sinners in need of a Savior, and that God sent a Savior through the Lord Jesus Christ. And then you can imagine what he says again, because he wrote these things in Romans. He knew what the Romans needed. He knew what all people needed. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all have sinned. And he probably would expound upon that as he unfolded the law. Is there anyone here who's never told a lie? Anyone here who's never stolen anything? Anyone here? And he would point out that all have sinned, because the scriptures say all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And Paul was aware of that, and he's proclaiming that message. And what he's saying to folks in general is this: we are born dead, separated from God, alienated from him. This is the condition of all mankind from the time of their birth. And it's important to understand that. Then he makes another claim, I think, as he's preaching to these people. Here it is. Jesus is the only way to be made alive. Jesus is the only way to be made alive. Acts chapter 28, verse 23. When they had appointed a day for him, they came to him in his lodging in greater numbers. And what's he doing? He's preaching the kingdom of God. What's he trying to do now? Convince them of Jesus. The only way you're going to get in the kingdom of God, the only way you're going to be forgiven of your sins, the only way that you will be right with God is if you come to know Jesus. That's the only way. Now, to the Jews, of course, this is a bit shocking as he proclaims Christ. But that's what Christ did all through his life, proclaim in the cities of Jerusalem and Judea and all those surrounding areas that he was the Son of God, and he was the one who would be the one who would be the Lamb of God, as John said, that takes away the sin of the world. And Paul is trying to convince them that your Messiah has already come, and his name is Jesus. And so the kingdom of God, what is the kingdom of God? Well, it's a spiritual rule. We don't see the kingdom of God with horses or tanks or armies. Though one day Christ will come and he will set up a literal kingdom on earth. We call that the millennial kingdom. But right now, Christ is ruling in his kingdom through the hearts of those who believe in him. And if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you're willing to live for the Lord Jesus Christ, you've put your trust and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are part of that kingdom. You are part of the kingdom of God. And Paul was declaring this to those Jewish folks that came to hear him. Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, this is what Jesus preached. It said, from that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, notice this, repent, for the kingdom of heaven, which is synonymous with the kingdom of God, is at hand. Incidentally, the way you get into the kingdom is repentance. No one gets into the kingdom without realizing that they are spiritually dead, separated, alienated from God, and they need to be brought into the kingdom by rebirth, by being born again. And once we're born in the flesh, but now born in the spirit as we come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. So, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 tells it this way. In him, in Jesus, we have redemption through his blood. Notice what we get. The forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. We have lied, we have stolen, we have cheated. We've done every kind of thing that can break the commandments. What do we receive when we come to Christ? Redemption. We've been bought back out of the marketplace of life, placed into the family of God. The grace of God has been laid upon us. We have been forgiven of our sins and enter into the family of God. This is the wonderful thing, the wonderful message that we have to proclaim. But here's what we do. We proclaim it to dead people. We're proclaiming it to people who do not know who God is and why Jesus came. In John chapter 4, verse 24, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my words, and this is the great struggle going on, having people actually hear. It doesn't just mean verbally hearing. It means hear and allow it to sink in. Everyone who hears my words and believes him who sent me has eternal life. It does not come into judgment, but he has passed from death into life. And so this is the way it happens. And you and I need to understand that there's the message of the gospel, and the gospel says that all people are born spiritually dead. But the answer to spiritual death is the Lord Jesus Christ. And when a person receives the Lord Jesus Christ, they pass from death unto life. So in Romans 5:17, for if because of one man's trespass death reigned through one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. And so this is the wonderful promise. And we offer it, though, to dead people. And this is where the struggle comes in. You are telling people that need a Savior that they are dead in their trespasses and sins, and they are alienated and separated from God. And that is not a message a lot of people want to hear. And so there's a resistance to the gospel, and we need to understand what takes place when we share Christ, because we are truly living among dead people. So we need to know the message of the gospel. All are born dead spiritually, and Jesus is the only way to be made alive. But then we need to go beyond that, and we need to see what the reaction of people will be when we share that message. The reaction of people, and there are basically two reactions when you and I share Christ with individuals. Some come alive. Isn't that wonderful? You share Christ, they hear the gospel. Now, some people are just ready and ripe to hear the gospel. They are so tired of walking around in brokenness and being separated from God and knowing that there's a problem and not figuring out the cure. And then you come along and you tell them about a Savior who died on their behalf. And they're ready to listen. Some respond. And so in Acts chapter 28, verse 24, and some were convinced by what he said. Some, not all, but some were convinced by what he said. Now what happened? Well, he's preached the gospel to them, and he says, here's what takes place to them, and this is what takes place when some respond. Acts chapter 2, 1, you were dead in your trespasses and sins, separated from God. You were alienated. It says, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, and the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. That's what it was before. But now when you come to Christ, things change. He says, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh. Dead people live only for now. Dead people live only in the flesh. Dead people only see today. Dead people say we die and it's over. No, that's not the way it is, but that's how they think it is. Dead people live in the flesh. They're going to get all the gusto they can, and they're going to get it before they end leaving this world. They've got a bucket list. I got a bucket list too. It's to see Jesus. That's the bucket list that we all need to have. And so dead people are living in the world. And so among whom we all once lived in the passion of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind. Have you ever wondered why this world is such a mess? Here it is. The majority in this world are dead people, spiritually separated from God. And they carry out the desires of the body and the mind. And what by nature, children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. And so when you become born again, when you become a child of God, you have a change of nature and a change of directions. All of a sudden you realize, man, I was one of the walking dead. But now I'm alive in Jesus. And something has changed in my life. So Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, but God, and that's the great but in our lives, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, here's what he did. He made us alive together with Christ, and for by grace you have been saved. Any dead person that wants to be made alive needs to go to the great physician, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will heal them and change their lives and make them children of the living God. And so the reaction of people when you share the gospel, some will come alive. But here's something else to know. Some stay dead. Some stay dead. Acts chapter 28, verse 24, but others disbelieved. Have you ever been pushed away by somebody as you're trying to share the gospel? You could just feel that wall of resistance. They're pushing and they're pushing. Why are they pushing? Because dead people are pushing because they're living in the realm of this world and they don't want to hear. I've often heard people say, what do I have to give up to become a Christian? Answer, sin. You have to give up living your own life your own way and get a new captain of your life. And that's what they don't want because they're dead in their sins and trespasses. And some will not listen, it says. But verse 25, disagreeing among themselves, they departed after Paul and had made one statement. Paul makes this statement to them. The Holy Spirit was right in saying to your fathers through Isaiah the prophet, go to this people and say, you will indeed hear, but never understand. And you will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull. And with their ears they can barely hear. And with their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand understand with their heart, and I would heal them. So we share. Some people receive. Some people reject. We're aware of that. But let me share something. Every time you share the gospel, everybody knows. You are an aroma, it says. Listen to what it says in 2 Corinthians 2:14. But thanks be to God, who in Christ Jesus leads us to a triumphal procession and through us spreads the fragrance and the knowledge of him everywhere. Now notice this. For we are the aroma of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. There's a Christian in the room. Get it? This man, what is it? Their life is different. There's the joy of God. There's the well-being that comes from knowing the Lord and being forgiven of your sins and guaranteed heaven. There's a sense of the presence of God, and that's what God wants us to reflect in the world. And when we're around people who don't know the Lord, they still know something's different, something's unique. And the aroma of God should be smelt among believers. In chapter 2, verse 16, to the one a fragrance of death to death, they know there's something wrong. That's why the pushing away. They know there's something wrong. And then to the other, a fragrance of life to life. Have you ever walked in a place and immediately said, I know a believer? That's a believer. That's a believer. I know that's a believer. And I know because the fragrance that comes out of their life. And we ought to be that way everywhere we go. Some people say, well, I don't want to be around you. And that's because they know they're dead. But there's the witness of Christ. And it's a wonderful thing that God will use you to witness to his son. Well, there's the message of the gospel. We are all born dead spiritually, and Jesus is the only way. We need to know that. And we also need to know the reaction of people. Some come alive, and some stay dead. What's the next thing we see in this text? After understanding those things about the gospel and about how people respond, we need to understand what our response should be to those responses. What should they be? What should it be? How do we respond to people as we attempt to share Christ? Here's the thing that we should know. We should preach to the willing. The first thing we should do is preach to the willing. Listen, if I go to a hospital room and there are two people in the hospital room, and I say, hey, I'm Pastor Sal, I'd love to talk to you, maybe pray with you. One guy says, keep away. The other guy says, Pastor, I'd be glad to pray with you. Which one do I go to? I go to the one that says, I'd be glad to pray with you. Because I want to know that he knows Jesus before he dies. He's ready. I'm ready to share. He's not ready. I don't want to write him off, but I'm going to this guy first because he's ready. And so he's the one that's ready to open his heart and his mind, and God opens his heart and mind. So we're ready to go. So here's what Paul did. He preached first to the willing. Notice Acts 28, verse 28. Therefore, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. They will listen. Okay, you won't listen? I have a crowd that will listen. I have somebody that will listen. The Gentiles will listen. Now, we're going to share in a moment why Paul did this. But he tells them they'll listen. And he goes and he shares the message with the Gentiles. But then what do we do after we do that? They receive the gospel. Great. You go to two people. One will listen. He receives the gospel. One won't. What do you do with that person? Do you write them off? No. You don't write them off at all. There's a reason you want to this one first. You want to this one first to get this one interested in the gospel. Let me show you how that works. You need to pray for the unwilling, and in praying, you need to provoke them with the truth. Now, here's how this works. Acts chapter 28, verse 20. For this reason, therefore, I ask you to see and to speak with you, since it is because of the hope of Israel I'm wearing this chain. He's talking to the Jews. Now, what is he doing? He's praying for the hope of Israel. Yet he says to them, I'm going to go to the Gentiles. But what is his thinking in doing that? Why did he say that? Was it to write them off? No, it wasn't at all. It was to get their attention. Let me read it in the book of Romans. Romans chapter 10, verse 1. Brothers, my heart's desire and prayer to God for them is that they may be saved. He's talking about the Jews. He's talking about Israel. Then he says in verse 11, so I ask, did they stumble in order that they might fall? They're not listening. They're pushing away. Is that the purpose? They might fall. I went to the Gentiles that they might fall. Not at all, he's saying. Rather, through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles. Notice why. So as to make Israel jealous. What is happening? Well, here's what happens. You have two people with a messed up life. One of them knows he's messed up. The other one wants to stay in that arena. So you go to the one that's willing to listen because this one keeps pushing you away. And you share Jesus with the one willing to listen. Now all of a sudden his life begins to come together. He has purpose and meaning. He's now serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. His life begins to take a radical change. This guy keeps saying, why is my life such a mess? Why is it so terrible? Then he looks at his buddy and says, why is this guy getting all together? And all of a sudden he's jealous. All the attention's being given to this guy because his life's falling together. And God wants to use that person's changed life to be an attraction to the one that resisted the gospel. And that's what God wants to do with you and me. Do you know anybody who was an alcoholic who laid down the bottle and changed their life? They become attractive to people who are caught. In fact, I often hear alcoholics say to me, Sal, you can't deal with alcoholics. You never had a drinking problem. I know how to deal with it. Why? They've been in that world, and they can talk about being set free. And people who can talk about being set free, people have had broken lives and broken marriages. They come to Christ, and their life gets healed, and their marriage gets healed. All of a sudden, they have a testimony to the world. And these people over here begin, why are they doing so well? I know why they're doing so well. Because they have Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And they're getting their lives in order. And when they get their lives in order, other people begin to see that. And that person that was pushing so hard all of a sudden sees the power of God in the life of the person that received the gospel. So he goes on to say in verse 12, now if their trespass means riches for the world, and if their failure means riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their full inclusion mean? Verse 13, now I am speaking to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am an apostle to the Gentiles. I magnify my ministry. God's called me to preach to the Gentiles, but behind that, here's my thinking. He says in verse 14, in order to somehow make my fellow Jews jealous. Jealous. And thus save some of them. In other words, Paul wants them to know that I'm preaching to the ones that were willing. I'm preaching to the Gentiles. And I know you got hard hearts and you're slow to hear. But I want you to get jealous about what God is doing over here. So God will work over here. And so he says in verse 15, for if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? And so you and I are to live a life in such a way, when you become a Christian, if there is no difference in the way you respond to life and the way you behave and what you do, you're not a sweet aroma. But if you are living a righteous Christian life, surrendered to the Lord Jesus Christ, you are attractive to dead people, to a broken world who are looking for hope and for answers. And when they see that you are living above and beyond all the circumstances of life because you have a Savior who sees you through and walks with you, and you know Him personally, and you are assured of the presence of God and going to heaven, all of a sudden you become attractive. And that's what Paul wants us to be. He wants us to be attractive. This is how we should live. So in Acts chapter 28, verse 30, he lived there 2 whole years at his own expense. And notice what he did. He welcomed all. He understood how to make other people jealous, but he welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. Now the goal is that we can say to as many as possible, Jesus is Lord, and see them come to Christ. The goal is that I go to the easy fruit because it's, you know, I used to have a preacher buddy, evangelist. He used to say, you know, when I evangelize, I look for the lower fruit first. I don't need a ladder to get up there. I look for the lower fruit first. But then when that's picked, I go for the other. And that's how it is in life. You have relatives and neighbors, and some of them are ready to hear the gospel. Go to them. Let their lives be a shining example of what Jesus Christ does when a life is changed. And then others will see and take notice because they will see a genuine experience of a life changed by the Lord Jesus Christ. So we need to be able to do that. So we need to know the gospel. We need to recognize the difference in reactions. And we need to respond to the willing and pray that God provokes the unwilling. And we never, never stop sharing the gospel. Now here's my goal. When you leave here today, and you go back to the marketplace of life, I want you to look around, and then here's what I want you to see. Well, I see dead people all around me. I see dead people all around me. And then I want you to understand that the reason you see dead people all around you is because God wants you to be a messenger of life so that they might come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. There are dead people all around, but there's some live ones right in the middle. Glorify Jesus with your life and make it count for the gospel. Let's pray together. Father, help us to see dead people all around us and to have the heart that Paul had. He would do anything that he could possibly do by all means to save some. And Lord, we long to see dead people born again. And may that happen. May you use us as light in a dark world and as living among the dead. And may you be glorified to increase the number of the living for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you and God bless you.